New Life, we are so excited to be here this weekend. Before we start with today's worship set, I just want to tell you something that I learned in Sunday school. And if you were raised in the church, it goes like this. Here is a church with a steeple. Open the doors, see all the people. And what I've learned in my own personal walk with Christ is actually, here's a building, take down the steeple, open the doors, the church is the people. We are the church. The big Hershey kiss we meet in every single week, that is not the church, that is just a building. Right now, in your homes, in your PJs, with your coffee, with your dog in the background, with your kids running around, you are the local church. And so this morning, I just want to encourage us, as we are in our homes, the same way they met in Acts when the early Christian church was established, that's exactly what we're doing today. And so my prayer for all of us is as we sing these songs, as we sit with our family and our kids and we hold each other, as we go through this corona crisis happening, that we will not lose faith, we will not lose hope, and know that God's love, his grace, and mercy will overcome all.
A hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes and fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm.
Sing a little louder. When the heart is under fire, another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. I was another in the standing next to me, was another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burdens, where another died for me, was another in the fire. My dead left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall into space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be. Come with me in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning. I know I will never be alone. I know I will never be alone. Need another in the fire. Stay next to me. Be another in the waters.
Joy from there.
I'll be another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding, how good you've been to me? I'll count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. Count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be.
You called me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where fear may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, an ocean's deep, my faith will abounds in deepest waters, your sovereignness will be my guide. Where fear may fail and fear surround me, you never failed and you won't start now. So Spirit, lead me where my dress is without borders. my soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours, and you are mine. Oh. And you.
Yeah, I'm really glad right now that we get to have this time of communion together. In fact, if you haven't prepared some bread and some juice right now, I'm gonna just invite you to go ahead and push pause on this and go ahead and get those things ready. I know sometimes at a time of communion, we think, well, I'm not qualified for that, or I need someone to lead me through that. But truth is, wherever you are today, whether you're just watching this on your phone or whether you're home with your family or a friend or just your spouse or even a small group together, many of you have been doing that. This is a time that we can gather together and do something that builds our unity and our faith and our community together. You know, during this season and this time when there's so much that divides us, right? We've seen that over the past months, just even politically and ideologically. There's so many things that divide us. And now, on top of that, we have the COVID-19 crisis. And we have social distancing, which Jeremy and I are participating in right now. But taking those steps to make sure that we're healthy and safe and all that. But the tendency is that we've just been divided one more time. We have separation physically, socially, sometimes emotionally. But here is the important thing. There's no division among us spiritually. In fact, when Jesus led his disciples to a time of communion and of faith together, it was to unite them together, that they could be one family, that no matter what had divided them before, that they were coming together in one faith. And that's what we get to do today.
Yeah, one of my favorite parts of the story of the communion, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, it says that Jesus was actually reclined back in his chair and he was just kind of enjoying the conversation of the other disciples who were there. And I can't help but wonder what was going on in the mind of Christ as he was looking around at the disciples. First of all, how much he loved them, but also thinking that they had no idea what was about to happen over the next 42 to 72 hours. And it was then when he sat up and then he said, I want to do something that's even going to pull us into a tighter relationship to make us even more unified and more one in the same family.
And so as they gathered together on that Passover night, Jesus took the bread. And I want you at home to go ahead and take the bread. And Jesus took that and he broke it. And he said, this is my body that's broken for you. So however you're doing that at home, I want you to take that bread and let's eat together.
And then in the same manner, Christ had just finished passing around the one loaf of bread that he had in front of him. And I love the part, I love in the story where he didn't tell all of the disciples to take their own loaf of bread. He took his, symbolizing his body, and then he passed it around and in the same manner he did it with his cup. And he said, this cup, this juice represents my blood that's going to be spilled out for all of the sin forever, for all of humanity. And so let's drink together to remember what Christ did on the cross 2,000 years ago.
So I don't know if you've ever received communion at home. I don't know if you've ever taken that step to gather with those that you love, to unite even closer together. But here's what's amazing to me is that across our country, across our world, definitely across our community and those of you that are a part of this, watching it right now. I hope it's more than just watching, that you're entering in and that we are united together as one body, one faith, together, one family of God. So would you pray with me? Father, I thank you so much for your gift of life to us. Thank you, Lord, that you sent your Son to give us hope and freedom and forgiveness. And Lord, as we've had a chance just to gather together, to break bread and to take the cup, Lord, thank you for the unity that you bring. Thank you that you are knitting our hearts and our lives together, that we truly are one faith, one body, one baptism. We are one family together in you. Lord, your word says that because of your work on the cross, that there is healing for us, healing spiritually. Lord, I believe healing physically, healing relationally. Lord, in every area of our life, you offer freedom and hope. And so we thank you for this momentary pause in a crazy world right now to remember your goodness and your gift towards us. We pray all this today in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue on in worship as we sing this powerful song together. So wherever you're at, I want you to join in and let's sing together.
And then proclaim, my God, how great.
Father, we thank you so much. We thank you for these songs as reminders that no matter what happens during this time of crisis, just like we sang in Oceans, the same way in the scriptures, when the apostles woke you up from your nap and said, we're gonna drown, we're gonna drown. And you just looked out into the oceans and you said, be still. And it was still. And that same voice that said the oceans to be still is the same voice that we're asking for right now in our lives to help our anxiety, our chaos, all the unknowns to just go away. And that we trust you, that we lean towards one another, our family, through FaceTime, through Skype, through Zoom, that we will never lose hope, knowing that you have us right where you want us and you are guiding us exactly through this storm. And all we have to do is just follow your lead. So we thank you so much again that we have the opportunity to come together as one church family. Give you all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So at this time, go ahead, grab your cup of coffee, get all cuddly with your family, and enjoy this weekend's message.
Hey, New Life family, it's so good to be with you again this weekend. This is the fourth weekend in a row where we've been coming to you through your screen, but we will do this as long as we have to because we want you to stay safe, we want you to stay healthy, and so we just thank God that we're able to do that. So thank you for joining us in worship. Freddie and Taylor and their team did a great job this morning, this weekend. Also, we want to thank you for taking communion with us this weekend. And so we hope that it was as special for you as it was for us. And so someone was just asking me this week, they said, hey, how weird is it speaking to just a camera with no one else in the room? Trust me, I would rather be speaking to hundreds of your beautiful faces, but this is the way that we're going to have to do it for a while. And I said, I'm not going to lie to you, it's incredibly awkward. It's really weird for us to be to just be communicating to a camera. But here's one of the things that I've seen about this that I've not noticed until now. Over the last couple of weeks, so let me just give you a little bit of the backstory behind this. So on any given Sunday at the Patterson campus, we average anywhere from 2 to 250 people that gather for both of our services in Patterson. Over the last 2 weeks, our online services for the Patterson campus has had over 2,000 views. That's pretty amazing, okay? And it's not because of me. It's not because of any one person. It's because of now we've made it. We've created another resource where you can put in the hands of people that you love, your neighbors, your family, and they are watching this. I know maybe it's 1,500 of those views may be coming from my grandmother, my 91-year-old grandmother in Florida, because I'm her favorite grandson, but it doesn't matter. We've had over 2,000 views, and we just want to say thank you. Thank you for staying connected to us because we love you. We've been praying for you. And I promise we're going to get through this and we're going to be back together really soon. So let me just go through a few announcements real quickly. First is don't forget about all the weekly resources that we have for you on our social media pages, Instagram and Facebook. We also have stuff for students and for kids. And we want you to stay connected, okay? So make sure that you keep up with all the updates. In fact, you can text the word update. The word update to 30500 and keep up with everything that's happening here at New Life. You can also text the word prayers to that same number, 30500, for any prayer needs that you have. So P-R-A-Y-E-R-S, it'll take you to a link and you can fill out whatever prayer need you have because we want to stay connected to you through the area of prayer as well, okay? And then lastly, I'm really excited about this one. This is Holy Week. And beginning this weekend, this is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday is the Sunday before Easter Sunday. And the week between those two Sundays is called Holy Week. So every day this week, beginning this weekend, beginning Palm Sunday, we have an additional resource for you. It's just a few scriptures and a song and even a little bit of a connection between social media and you. Throughout the week, every day. It doesn't take long, but it's another great way for you and I to be able to stay connected to one another. Also, we're really excited about this. We are still doing a Good Friday experience, and we're going to do it live on Friday. So make sure you stay up to date with when and where we're going to be doing those things what time that you can tune into social media when we go live with a Good Friday experience. It's not going to take very long, but it's going to be very reflective, and we just want to encourage you to do that. Also, we're also doing something different this year. We've never done this before in the history of New Life as well, but we are doing a sunrise service on Easter morning. Okay, so it's going to be live as well. So write all this down. I know this is a lot of information that's coming to you like a fire hydrant right now, like a water hose. But we just wanted to make sure that you are staying connected to us and us to you. So Holy Week is this week, a Good Friday experience live on Friday, and then a sunrise service along with our Easter services next weekend as well. Okay, now that's enough announcements. Let's get to this weekend's message. But before we do, we have some friends of ours who pastor a church called Flood Church down in Southern California, and they did something unique with their announcements this week to kind of take away some of the awkwardness of worshiping in your living room. Check out this video.
Hallelujah, family. That was an awesome time of worship. Now, your home just became the sanctuary. Now, I want to just give you permission to give yourself some grace, because I know some of y'all was in the worship, be thou my vision, and then little Bobby ran across your foot, okay? Sit down and just pop back into worship. It's fine. It's fine. Be quiet. Mama's worshiping. And then just get right back to it. It is fine. No judgment here.
Well, when Pastor Dave sent that to us, we were just all laughing because we thought that's exactly how it is at some of your homes. So we wanted to take away some of that awkwardness and just know that you have permission to discipline your children while you're trying to worship at the same time, okay? Well, we are going to kick off this weekend's message the way that we have with all of the other messages in this series with the theme verse of this series, which is found in Psalm chapter 77, verse 14. And it says this, "You are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the peoples." So we're still diving into this series called Miraculous, and I can't wait to get to the one that we're going to be talking about today. But first, let me just say, I love water. Not just drinking water, but I love being around water. It doesn't matter if it's the ocean or a lake or a stream or a creek or even a swimming pool. Water is my happy place. You get me near water, and my mood immediately will change. I mean, even my favorite superhero has always been Aquaman. I had a season pass every summer to the local pool where I grew up. I was a lifeguard for several years after that. When Janet and I first got married, we bought a ski boat. I mean, I can't get enough of it. I love the water. Back when I was younger and in much better shape, I used to be able to hold my breath for a really long time, and I would take a big deep breath. I would go down to the bottom of the pool, and I would close my eyes, and I would just sit there. And in that moment, that was one of the most peaceful places in the world for me. I remember when I was a kid, I used to try my best to run on the water. Have you ever done this? You just take off running from the side of the pool or the beach going into the ocean. And man, you just run as hard as you can. And as soon as your feet hit the water, you start turning your legs as fast as you can because you want to try to see how far you can actually run on the water or walk on the water. And you realize that you only made it about 3 feet before you start to sink. Well, over the last several weeks, we've been talking about the miracles of Jesus and really connecting them with our lives today. And so if you grew up going to church, you probably know the miracle that we're going to be talking about today, which is Jesus walking on top of the water. If you missed any of the messages over this series, just want to encourage you to go back and to listen to them because it's good that you find out how these miracles can apply to your life as well. So the miracle of Jesus walking on the water takes place right after the miracle of him feeding 5,000 people, which we talked about last week. And this miracle of Jesus walking on the water is actually recorded in 3 of the 4 Gospels. Now, if you're new to the faith, the Gospels are the first 4 books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Those are also called the biographies of Jesus. And so the miracle of Jesus walking on top of the water is found in 3 of those 4 Gospels, but only Matthew includes the role of Peter in the story. So let's look at Matthew chapter 14, the very first book of the New Testament, verses 22 through 33, and it says this. Immediately after this, Jesus insisted that his disciples get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake. Immediately after what? After he fed the 5,000. while he sent the people home. After sending them home, he, Jesus, went up to the hills by himself to pray. Now, he went there to begin with to get alone with the Father, and then the crowd came, and then he fed the 5,000. But night fell while he was still there, while he was there alone. Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from land, for a strong wind had risen, and they were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them, walking on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified, and in their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost." But Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." Then Peter called to him, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you, walking on the water." "Yes, come," Jesus said. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind and waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Jesus immediately, now I want you to remember that word, underline it, circle it, whatever you got to do. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. "You have so little faith," Jesus said. "Why did you doubt me?" When they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped. Then the disciples worshiped him. "You really are the Son of God," they exclaimed. Now, when it comes to the story of Jesus walking on the water and Peter joining with him, we often focus on Jesus' power over the elements or over nature, walking on water and the winds ceasing and etc. But I want to focus on Peter this weekend, because when we hear and study about the miracles of Jesus walking on the water, most of us would think, well, of course he did. He's Jesus, right? I mean, he's healing the sick, he's raising the dead, feeding thousands of people with nearly nothing. Why wouldn't Jesus walk on the water? But again, the miracles weren't for Jesus. It was for humanity's belief in him. It was to bring glory and honor to the Father, along with increasing the faith of believers. Jesus was communicating something to his disciples and the rest of humanity in this miracle, that no matter what's going on around us, keep your eyes on Jesus. Because 2,000 years later, we may not be seeing physical storms and physical waves that distract us and cause us to lose our focus and from the safety and the protection of Jesus, but we are being distracted even this weekend. Even right now, we're being distracted. COVID-19, stock market ups and downs, business shutdowns, company layoffs, full hospitals, quarantine, self-quarantine, shelter in place, food pantries, school closures, homeschooling, positive, negative, test kits. Those are all words in our regular vocabulary now. And all of the waves that have been crashing into us have been assigned one of those names. There are millions of Americans and others all around the world who are calling out to Jesus during this pandemic, during this crisis, and they're asking, "Jesus, are you there? Jesus, do you even see what's going on? Jesus, what are you going to do about this?" What I've learned in my own personal life storm experiences, or when I face a crisis myself, there's only one way to walk on the water with Jesus, and I got to get out of the boat. That's it. Now, I don't mean physically walking on the water, but what I'm talking about is getting through a crisis with Jesus by my side, trusting that I'm going to get through it because he's with me, trusting that if I begin to sink or drown, that he's close enough beside me to pull me to safety, just in case my faith isn't strong enough. Because the sea is scary. The world around us is filled with a lot of junk right now, and just like Peter, we're reluctant to step out. We're reluctant to leave the boat and trust that we're not going to sink and drown. But here's the problem. You see, some of us actually believe that the boat is safer because we can feel it. We can touch it. It's familiar. We find our security in that. We can hold on to it. But Jesus is saying, let go of that and trust me. Don't put your faith in what you can feel. Put your faith in me. Don't put your faith and your hope and your trust in paychecks or in congressmen or in incentives and bailouts. All of those things are great, and they're going to be helping millions of Americans. I get that. But Jesus is saying, don't put your hope and your faith and your trust in those things, because those things are temporary. Jesus is eternal. You see, we fall into this trap of believing that my comfort zone or my unbelief or my unwillingness to take risk and believe in the supernatural is safer and better than stepping out into this illusion of safety. But listen, Jesus is not an illusion. He offers hope and peace beyond what we believe to be safe. But you and I, we have to take the first step. We have to take that first step towards Jesus. So write this down for number one. Here's your first fill-in for the weekend. One small step of faith brings me closer to Jesus. One small step of faith brings me closer to Jesus. And you might be thinking, wait, Jeremy, my step, that means I have the control. That means all of the power and everything. It's in my court, right? No. Listen, remember in the story, Jesus was already walking towards the disciples, but he only came so far. It still requires faith on our part to walk towards Jesus. He's already came his distance to us. Now it's up to us to take our step towards him. Because I believe that Jesus will only come so far before he stops and asks, okay, do you believe? Are you going to come towards me? Peter thought Jesus was a ghost and he still took a risk and stepped out towards him. I love Peter. I think he's one of the most relatable people in the Bible. If you've never studied the life of Peter, I think you'll find him very applicable to your life as well. But here's something else I noticed in this story. Why didn't the disciples recognize Jesus? They thought he was a ghost. Why didn't they recognize Jesus? I mean, up to this point, they've spent a pretty good amount of time with him. They didn't just decide to start following Jesus on this day. They've seen him perform other miracles. They've eaten with him. They've traveled with him. So why didn't they recognize Jesus? Well, I believe it's mainly because of some of the same reasons that you and I don't recognize Jesus. You see, when we get distracted by all the waves and the storms around us, we tend to lose our focus. We tend to take our eyes off of Jesus, and before you know it, we don't recognize him because we're too focused on the storm that we're in. Fear will sink us, while faith allows us to walk on the water with Jesus. The power and presence of God is evident in our lives when we take that step of obedience to what Jesus is saying to us. So let me ask you, what do you think Jesus is saying to you during this season? We went through a whole series last year back in the fall called Rooted, and we talked about all these different ways to connect with God through nature and through prayer, through reading scripture. If you go back and you re-listen to some of those messages, what way do you think you're connecting best with Jesus? Now, I can tell you for me, I've never listened more for the voice, that inner voice inside me or the God's voice in my life than ever before. I've never listened for him as much as I am now because he has my attention. I wake up thinking about it. I go to bed thinking about it. I think about it all day long. I'm listening because I want to make sure that I lead the same way that Jesus is leading me. So what do you think Jesus is trying to communicate to you? Just you. During this national crisis, what if we looked at it with different eyes? What if we looked at it from a different perspective? Because last week we mentioned perspective. We talked about the two intersecting crowds last week, that on the same day that something great is happening for one person, something tragic is happening to another. In fact, this week I had someone stop me on the road and they began to explain how what's happening in our country has actually created a sort of divine opportunity for them and their family to move forward in a career transition. They've been praying to God for God to somehow close the door that they're currently walking through and to open up a new door. Now they have the chance to do so. I read something that another pastor wrote in his blog this week that really got me thinking about New Life, not just the Patterson campus, but New Life as a whole. And he said this, whatever is on the other side of this required a complete global disruption. Many people are just waiting for normal to return, but this is a time to pray, to plan, and to prepare. Disruptions come to liberate from what was and prepare you for what's next. That's pretty powerful. The big question for this message remains, do you have the faith and the courage to step out of the boat? Everyone watching this weekend represents one of those 12 disciples in that boat. Are you going to be one that's sitting down and hanging on and scared to death and maybe even sick? Or are you going to be like Peter and step out? I believe this weekend the Lord is inviting every single one of us to take a step of faith towards Him, to believe and have faith that He's calling us away from the comfortable, away from the ordinary, and into some of the rough and scary territory that's extraordinary to take us to another level in our relationship with Him. The first step we know is usually the scariest, right? But Jesus is saying to us, keep your eyes on Me. Don't look around. Stay focused on Me. Go ahead and take that step. Don't listen to the enemy, because he's going to try to discourage you and convince you that you're not good enough, that it's not going to work, that you're going to sink, that you're going to drown. Don't listen to him. Jesus is inviting us to step out of the boat into courage, into hope, into faith. Notice he's inviting us. He's not forcing us. It's up to us as to whether or not we want to obey him. But don't be afraid. Be bold and be strong. Because Peter just simply said, if that's you, invite me to come. And Jesus said, well, come. We get to do the same thing. And we should do it without fear. Look what it says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. In the book of Deuteronomy, in the Old Testament, chapter 31, it says this, so be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not panic before them. For the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. Now, a lot of people, maybe a lot of Bible scholars say, oh, that's not for today. That was for the Jewish people. That was for the nation of Israel all those years ago. No, I believe it's for us today. It couldn't be more real than it is for us today. So write this down for number two. Staying close to Jesus is the safest place to be. Staying close to Jesus is the safest place to be. When we leave our comfort zone to follow Jesus, we're always better off. I've never met anyone who's regretted walking in obedience with God for a stronger relationship with Jesus. In fact, my dad has this saying that he said all my life. I've heard him say it all my life. He says this, my worst day as a believer is still better than my best day as an unbeliever. Experiencing close and intimate fellowship with Jesus absolutely spoils us for any other kind of life. And we can either have little faith or no faith at all. But only one of those leads to greater faith. Now think about this. Jesus' assessment of Peter's faith was little. He even said, why do you have little faith? But little faith is still some faith. After all, he was the only one of 12 that actually stepped out of the boat. When we have a little faith, God can take it and grow it into much more. But when you have no faith at all, there's nothing to grow. Do you believe and have faith that God is going to provide for you during this season? Do you believe and have faith that God is going to protect you and watch over you and keep you safe and keep you healthy? Are you willing to step out of the boat and walk towards Jesus? So here's my favorite part of the miracle, and I'm going to reread it again. Excuse me. It says this, but when he, Peter, saw the strong wind and waves, he was terrified and began to sink. Save me, Lord, he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. You have so little faith, Jesus said. Why did you doubt me? Look at this. When did Jesus say to Peter, you have little faith? It was after he saved him. And when did he save Peter? When Peter cried out to him. When Peter was scared. When Peter was afraid. When he began to sink. And so there's two things about this last part of that message. It really jumps out at me. This is the first thing. Peter still knew who he could cry out to for help. He still knew who he could cry out to for help. And the second thing is this, Jesus was close enough to grab him when he needed him. Do you really know who you can still cry out to for help when you're in the storm? Because if you do, Jesus is close enough to reach out and grab you. Immediately, he grabbed Peter. And when we cry out to Jesus and say, Jesus, save me, immediately, he reaches out and grabs us. When you're scared, when it seems you're going down, when the waves of life are crashing around you, you need to remember that Jesus has never left you. He's right there beside you during the storm that we're in. Even as a nation, as a country, Jesus is right there beside us. While we're busy being distracted by everything that's going on, He's right there beside us, and He's waiting for us to say, Jesus, save us. Jesus, save me. And that's when He'll reach out and do it. When Peter jumps out of the boat, I mean, think about it. His heart is full of all kinds of great intentions. And sometimes you and I, we take big leaps of faith and we're full of great intentions as well. But like Peter, our faith can vanish pretty quickly. But Peter's exercise of faith does not end in failure. Although he's sinking in fear, he calls out to the Lord, save me. God loves to hear our cry for help. He loves it when we reach out to Him for help. And you know why? Because it shows Him that we know that we can't save ourselves. It puts us in this realm of humility to go, we're going to die without You. We're going to sink without You. We're going to drown without You. We're going to fall under this enormous pressure of discomfort and situation that we're in. But we need to reach out. We need to ask Jesus to save us. For believers, I believe that the lesson here is unmistakable. If we take our eyes off Jesus and focus on our circumstances, we will fall under the weight of our problems. But if we call out to Jesus in faith, He'll catch us, He'll grab us, and will pull us above our seemingly impossible situation. Because for a moment there in the story, Peter allowed doubt to replace his faith. In all the time that he had spent with Jesus, even Peter, one of Christ's closest friends, was still learning to trust Him completely. So Jesus uses this experience to bring His followers into a better understanding of who He is as God, that He's in total control. And when Jesus is present, we can trust Him to either calm the storm or calm us. So how do we walk on water with Jesus? Easy. Just get out of the boat. We have to take the first step. We have to believe that Jesus is close enough beside us that if we do start to sink, all we have to do is cry out to Him to save us, and He will. Most of us are the other 11 disciples in the story. Most of us are not Peter. We're holding on to whatever we can in our life because we're terrified of what's happening around us. The wind is strong, the waves are huge. But Jesus is inviting us to trust Him, to go from ordinary, which consists of worry and fear and anxiety and brokenness and addictions and sin, to the extraordinary, which is peace and hope, and forgiveness and grace and love and joy. Trust is a huge storm to go through. I know a lot of people with some severe trust issues. But Peter never stopped trusting Jesus. He trusted Jesus enough to step out of the boat, and then he trusted Him even more to save him when he was in trouble. What would happen if we had that same amount of trust that Peter had with Jesus? So there's a couple of questions I want us to wrestle with during this Holy Week, okay? All this week. If you want to write these down, if you want to go back and rewatch this or push pause and get a piece of paper and pen or whatever, but here's two questions that I want us all to wrestle with this week. Here's question number one. What are you holding on to so tightly that's keeping you from stepping out towards Jesus? The disciples were holding on to the boat. That was their security blanket. They didn't want to let go. What are you holding on to too tightly that's keeping you from stepping out towards Jesus? Fear, comfort, money, addictions, normal, what is it? And here's question number two. What is it that's keeping you from putting your trust in Jesus that if you did begin to sink, okay, you took a step, now you're beginning to sink, what is it that's keeping you from putting your trust in Jesus that you couldn't cry out for Him to save you? Because whatever that is, let it go. Put it aside. And ask Jesus to save you. If you're beginning to sink, ask Jesus to save you. So like we said earlier, this weekend is Palm Sunday. Over 2,000 years ago this weekend, Jesus was making his celebrated entry into the city of Jerusalem, just 5 days before he was crucified and 1 week before he was raised from the dead. So all this week, I want all of us to reflect and respond to what Jesus did on the cross, number one, because this is just another way that our church, our entire church, New Life, can stay connected during the season. All this week, I want us to reflect on what Jesus did for us on the cross and then celebrate the fact that we now serve and we get to worship. We get to serve and worship a risen and living and breathing, all-powerful, all-knowing God. Let's celebrate together all this week going into Easter season. Will you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for another opportunity, Lord, to connect with our faith family, the body of Christ. Father, we know that storms are all around us. The wind is powerful. The waves are huge. But Lord, you are inviting us. You have already come so far our way, and now you've stopped, and you're bidding us to come to you. Father, give us the boldness and the courage and the faith and the trust to take that first step out onto that water, Lord. And as we begin to walk towards you, away from our security, away from the things that we can touch, Father, when we begin to sink, Lord, reach out and grab us. Give us the boldness and the courage to look at you and say, save us, Lord. And as we do that, let us trust that you will grab us and pull us to safety. Father, you are the King of all kings. Lord, you are the Lord of all lords, and we surrender and we trust our lives to you. As we go into this Holy Week, Father, I pray that we will just be better connected than ever before, that you will help us align our hearts with yours, that we'll be reflective of what you did on the cross 2,000 years ago, that you took the stripes for our sicknesses, that you shed your blood for our sin, and that 3 days later, you rose from the dead. And since then, we get to have a relationship with you. Thank you for that. We love you. We honor you. We surrender ourselves to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, just a couple real quick closing announcements. Don't forget, Friday, we're going to have a live Good Friday experience. And then Sunday morning early, tune into our social media pages, Facebook and Instagram. We're going to have a sunrise experience as well before we go into our Easter services. So don't forget all of the resources that we have available, the Holy Week resources that's going to be available to you. We love you guys, and we can't wait to be back with you live. But until then, we are going to celebrate with you in your living rooms, on your phones, on your tablets, however that looks. We love you. We want you to still stay connected. Don't forget about the giving opportunity that you have as well. We can't do what we do throughout the week without you. So thank you so much for being invested into New Life and into the Kingdom of God. We love you. We'll talk to you soon. Have a great week. We'll